variables. Wait a sec. Okay. There is the registration going on.
Okay. Thank you, Nicola. Okay, today I want to talk about pseudo-convexity, that is a classical topic in several complex variables. I want to investigate some peculiar phenomena in several complex variables, that is the domains of Murphy, the holomorphic convexity, the Levy pseudo-convexity, and something about plurisubharmonic function and homology. When you start to study several complex variables, we have some classical results that are very, very similar to the results in one complex variable. For example, the holomorphic functional analytic or analytic function, if you have the formula, the Cauchy formula for the polydisk. So a lot of results are very, very similar to one complex variable. Maybe the first strange phenomenon complex, several complex variables is the Artax phenomenon. And this is the following. We consider A and B between 0 and 1, and we consider the following domain in C2. Obviously, you can generalize the following domain also in higher dimension. And so it's a disk times an annulus union with a polydisk. So a very simple. Domain A is a subdomain of the bidisk, so disk times disk. Obviously, there is a problem to keep a picture of this domain, so you can forget about the complex variable if you consider it as a real variable, is a picture, so it's a psychological picture of this domain. Artox, in the beginning of last century, proved the following theorem. Each holomorphic function, this is the ring of holomorphic function from H to C. Each holomorphic function admits a unique extension in the bidisk. So every function defined here can be extended to a function defined in all the bidisk. The proof is very, very easy because we only use tools in one complex variable. We consider C between B and 1. If we consider the following circle in C, so the circle radius C, little c, and we define the following function. Now, so we consider the integral in the second variable, since C is bigger than B, is always in the, is a well-defined function because C is bigger than B, so in this annulus. And so this is a well-defined function and is holomorphic because the bar is equal to zero. Okay, and this is a well-defined function in D times CD. Now, when we are in AD times CD, we can use the formula, the Cauchy formula, and so capital F is equal to little f. And now for the negative principle, capital F and F in the inception of the two domains. No? So here, the section with H. And so we can define a global holomorphic function in the bidisk that is an extension of F. And so we have the Artax theorem. So every function here in H extends to a holomorphic function in the bidisk. Why is so interesting? First of all, we have a lot of similar examples. For example, we consider the polydisk without a polydisk inside, and all the functions here extend to a function here. The same for the polydisk without a point, and all the complex space without a point. We can change the polydisk with the Euclidean ball, it's not so important. This phenomenon is very, very, this phenomenon is very interesting because this does not happen in one complex variable, because if we have two domains, D in D prime, and D prime, we consider a point in D prime minus D. One over C minus P is a function that is holomorphic here, but obviously does not extend in D prime. So this phenomenon is a peculiarity of the several complex variables. And so we have the following definition. Moreover, we want the domains where phenomena does not happen. So a domain is a domain holomorphy if for each boundary point exists a global function in D, FP, such that for every component connected of a neighborhood U of P, does not exist a function here that is an extension of F in a connecting component of the intersection. Okay, so morally, we don't want the Hartog phenomenon. We want a similar thing of one complex variable. Why we need the connecting component? Because, for example, in C, we consider C without minus infinity zero, and we consider the logarithm. If we have the logarithm, obviously it's impossible to find an extension of the logarithm in U. Such that is an extension intersecting with D. But obviously we can find a logarithm that is an extension one of the components of D intersecting with U. So for this reason, we need a connecting component. Okay. So we are interested to study these class domains. We need some, results or example. Obviously, in dimension one, every domain is a domain holomorphy because for each point in a boundary, we can take the following function. And we have a counterexample in a higher dimension where the Hartog domain is not a domain holomorphy. And we have also a first result, very easy to put every domain in higher dimension is a domain holomorphy. Let's come back to the definition. We have to prove that for each boundary point, there exists a function that is not an extension of such as, sorry, that's with does not exist a local extension of the function, no? So we have to extract a function for every boundary point, so we can assume that the boundary point is the origin. Now, by convexity, there exists an R linear functional L that separates D. It means that D, for example, is in the set where the functional is a negative function. Now, the functional is, we can write the function in the following way, using Z zeta bar. And since it's a real function, is a relation for the coefficients. And now if we consider the two times the holomorphic part, is obviously an holomorphic function, and the real part of H is equal to L. And so since L is non-negative in D, the same is true for H. And so 1 over H is a well-defined holomorphic function that obviously does not extend in a neighborhood of 0. And so we can do this for every boundary point. And so the domain is a domain holomorphic. So we can find for every boundary point a function that does not extend locally in a neighborhood of the point. We want to study these class domains. The first problem, an analytical geometrical characterization, something that is very easy to check this property. And we can ask to find an intrinsic, if this, the question is to understand if this is an intrinsic property. Obviously, this is an extrinsic definition. We need to, there is a boundary, it is a domain of CD, so it's not an intrinsic definition, but maybe it's an intrinsic property of the domain. Let's start with the second question. A similar concept is the holomorphic convexity, the real geometry. We consider L, that is the space or real thing, affine mappings from R to R. And we can, for a compact set, we can define the convex L, that is the smallest convex set that contains K. And we can write this concept in the following way. The convex L are the points in RD, where for every real fine mapping, phi of x is smaller than the maximum of phi of k. Let's think about 2 points. K is 2 points. This set is the segment connecting the 2 points. No? And we have a remark that we can prove that an open set in RT is convex if and only if for each compact set the convex hull is compact indeed. So this is a proposition, it's an exercise. Okay. Okay, now the idea is to generalize this idea in the convex in the holomorphic case, changing the space of function. So considering the ring of holomorphic function. And so we can prove that if we have a ring, the holomorphic convex hull of K is the following set. So all the points in domain, such that the modulo of F is smaller than the maximum of F K for each holomorphic function of D. A compact set is OD convex if the holomorphic hull is equal to itself. And a domain is holomorphic convex if for each compact set, the holomorphic convex hull is compact in D. Okay, so this is a definition that we can do for every domain, so for every complex manifold. The interesting thing with this definition that is an intrinsic definition because this object is an intrinsic object. And so it's an intrinsic definition. So we have the following position. If we have a binomorphism between two domains, then D is holomorphically convex if only if the prime is holomorphically convex. And we can prove also some proposition about, for example, if you have two domains that are holomorphically convex, then the product is holomorphically convex. So it's very, very nice definition. Okay, let's give an example. In higher dimension, D is a CT without the origin, and K is the unit sphere. Sorry. Now, if you remember, we can prove the idea of Hartog that every function here has an unique extension here. Every holomorphic function is a unique extension here. So we have this. So the two rings are the same morally. And so using the maximal principle, accetto io, Nicola? So using the maximal principle, okay, with the modulus FF in zeta is smaller than the maximum of F when zeta is inside the ball for each holomorphic function in holomorphic in D, no? For the maximal principle, because every function extends to all CD. And so by definition, this implies that the ball, structure of the ball, the origin is in the holomorphic convex hull. And now using this function, we can prove that this is the best that we can have. So the holomorphic convex hull is exactly the closure of the ball without the origin. And this is obviously not a convex set of D. And so this domain is not holomorphically convex. Okay, now we can see that. Scusami?
Matteo, scusa. No, cos'è che intendi quando scrivi using the function f z equals z, we have you check the identity? Why?
Because in the definition here, you have to find that all the points in D such that for each function we have this, no?
Sì, yeah.
And now, if we consider the function f of z equal to zeta, we don't have this, no? If K is the unit sphere.
Ah, okay, yeah. Okay, then.
And so if zeta is is not worry, sorry. Okay. If the modulus zeta is bigger than one, it's not in the convex hull, because we can use this function to check that it is not in the convex hull. It's not so important that is exactly this. The important thing that we have this.
Okay.
Because now this is not a compact set of CD without the origin, no?
Okay.
Because and so this implies that this is not roughly complex. Okay.
Okay. Excuse me, the stupid question, but f of z is equal to z in one variable or in two variables?
You're right. Okay, you can use. You're right. Because we need. You can use then the f of z equal to zeta j for every j that you can prove. So yeah, you're right, this is false.
Okay.
Obviously, it's a function from CD to CD, no?
Yeah.
You're right.
Okay.
But the important thing that the convex hull is exactly this, but it's not so important. The important thing is that we have this. And so it's not homomorphically convex. And the tool, in order to prove this, is that we have this now, so that this is not a domain holomorphic. So there is a link between the two concepts, and there is this important theorem, that is the Cartan-Toulon theorem. A domain is holomorphically convex if and only if it's a domain holomorphic. And so, in particular, this domain holomorphic is an intrinsic property of the domain, because it is an intrinsic property. So, for example, the ball, something that is holomorphic to the unit ball, is always maybe the boundary is very wide, very difficult, but this is a domain holomorphic. Okay, I want to give you the sketch of the proof of this direction, because I don't know, I want to show you some techniques about this stuff. Okay, we need two facts. Fact one, that we can find a normal exhaustion, so a family of compact sets property and this property. So is the unit is all the domain, and we have this inclusion of with the open part of the compact set that is OD convex, K new favor for revenue. And fact two, we have that for each m and for each epsilon, and for each point that is not in the convex hull, holomorphic convex hull, okay, we can also always find a function holomorphic that is the modulus of p is bigger than m, and the maximum over k is smaller than epsilon. This is because by definition we can find a function holomorphic here, such that the module f of p is bigger than the maximum of k, by definition, that is not in the convex hull. And now you can change a function with a constant. We can apply, consider f to the power l for l bigger enough, and you can find the function with this property. So you can separate the compact set with a point and a point in the following sense. If the point is not in the convex hull. And now we have to prove that it's a domain holomorphic, so we have to find a function that is such that it is impossible to extend this function in a neighborhood of a given point in a boundary point. So we consider a boundary point, consider a sequence of points inside the space that converts to P with this property. And now we can find a sequence of functions such that the maximum over kj is smaller than 1 over the j, the power a, and with this property. This is because of fact 2. No? And now if we consider the function series, this is converted by this property here. And moreover, for every pj, we have this estimate. If you do the computation, we obtain it's bigger than j for every j. And so in particular, the limit of modulus of fpj is equal to infinity. And so it's impossible to extend this function in a neighborhood of p. because PJ converts to P and the modulus goes to infinity. This is the sketch of the proof of one of the direction of the Cartan Tourette theorem. This is the easy part, obviously. The other part is more complicated. Okay, let's talk about the second question. So, an analytic and geometric characterization of the domain Murphy. Oops. Come faccio a passare? Ok, scusate. Ok, that is the Levy pseudoconvexity. Again, the idea is to generalize the concept of convexity in a real geometry. We can define the convexity using the Hessian if the domain is smooth enough, no? So the idea is to, let's start with the real case. You have functions, C1 function, we can define the following functional. So DPR is more or less the scalar product with the gradient of R. And now if we do a domain, a boundary box, if we consider the neighbor of P, a local defining function is a CK function such that we can write the domain locally as the points where the function is a negative function. And moreover, we wanted to this operator is non-trivial in a neighborhood or in view. Okay, this is a local defining function. And in particular, the boundary is the zero set of R. Okay, now if we have a local defining function, we can define the tangent space for a domain with C1 boundary. And the tangent space is the curve of the operator DPR. And so since this is not a trivial operator, it's a vector space of dimension D minus one. You can prove that this definition does not depend from the choice of the local defining function. And so this is a vector space of dimension D minus one that you can define for every boundary point P. And now if you have a C2 function, you can define the Hessian in the following way. It's a real Abelian form that you can define in all RD. Okay, and now we have a characterization for the convexity for C2 domains. A domain with a C2 boundary is convex at P if the Hessian is positive semi-definite in tangent space. And is strongly convex if it is positive definite in tangent space. This is a definition. If you want, there's also a proposition, so that a domain is convex if and only if for every boundary point is convex at P in this sense. You can prove this. And so the idea is to generalize this idea for the complex case. Obviously, if this problem is to generalize the concept of tangent space, it is a real vector space. And so, first of all, we generalize this operator. So it's delta PR. That is a C-linear, and is the relation with the TPR is the following. And so the complex tangent space is the curve of delta PR. Since it's a C-linear operator, this is a complex vector space of dimension D minus one. If we have also the following relation with the real tangent space, the complex tangent space is intersection of the real tangent space and I times the real tangent space. Here it's very interesting because, for example, if you consider D equal to one, so we are in C, the complex tangent space is always equal to, is a trivial space because the dimension is equal to zero. So a way to see the big difference between the several complex variable and one complex variable, like the complex tangent space is always trivial in one complex variable. Okay, now you have to generalize the Hessian, and the generalization is the Levy form. have a C2 function. The Levy form is the following Hermitian form. So it's very similar to Hessian, but we have the derivative the zeta di zeta bar. And this is an Hermitian form that we can define in all CD. In a similar way for the real case, a domain with C2 boundary, if we have a local defining function, the Levy point is a Levy pseudo-convex if the Levy form is a semi-definite positive in the complex tangent space, and it's strongly Levy pseudo-convex if it's a positive definite in the complex tangent space. So the same definition of the real case, no? Again, it's very interesting that if we are in C, the space is trivial, so the zero, the vector zero, and so every Hermitian form is a Levy pseudo-convex, is a positive semi-definite, or if you want, positive definite. So every C2 domain in C is strongly Levy pseudo-convex, you know? Okay. I want to give you this lemma. This is a good relation with the Hessian. So more the Levy form is the average of between the Hessian in the direction B and direction IB. And so we have used this corollary. So if we have a domain that is with boundary, if it's convex, so this is bigger or equal to zero. The same is true for this. And so in particular, this is a bigger or equal to zero. And so it's Levy pseudo-convex. And the same is true for strongly convex implies strongly Levy pseudo-convex. So we have the same thing of the domain Sorolf, you know? The convexity implies the Levy pseudo-convexity. Okay. And moreover, the Levy form has a good relation with the holomorphic structure, because if you have a holomorphic function, then we have the following chain rule for the Levy form. And so using this formula, we can prove, for example, that if you have a domain with C2 boundary and a binomorphism F, this is defined in a neighborhood of a boundary point. This is important, is it defined in a neighborhood? The prime image. Now the image is strongly pseudo-convex, Levy pseudo-convex at FP, if and only if the initial domain is strongly Levy pseudo-convex at P. So the Levy pseudo-convexity is invariant by biomorphism if the biomorphism is defined in a neighborhood of the point. So attention, this not implies that it's strongly or Levy pseudo-convexity is biomorphic. You need to know that the biomorphism is defined in a neighborhood of the domain. Obviously, this is not true in general. Okay. Now I want to give you
Matteo. Can I ask you a question? Do you have an example of this last fact? I mean, two domains that are biholomorphically equivalent, but the biholomorphism is not defined on a neighborhood, so that one domain is pseudo convex.
Maybe
it's a hard question. I don't know. Maybe.
No, but in C you can you have the Riemann mapping theorem, so you can send the disk to every domain that is very wild. For example, C without.
Yeah, but then in C, everything is pseudo-convex.
We have an example. For example, there is a explicit formula. I don't know, but you can find something that, for example, is not C2. Something that is not very boundary is very bad.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Okay, some example I want to convince you that it's very easy to.
I'm sorry, Matteo. Following Alessandro's question, but if the other domain is a C2, then You said that you can find the bioholomorphic.
I think we can find some counterexample because yeah, there is an example of yeah, there are examples, but they are not so easy to. Okay. It's impossible to write the biomorphism, but you can find because if when you know that this is strong ipsilomics for first of all. We will see later that Levi pseudoconvexity is equivalent to, for example, holomorphic convexity.
Okay.
So it's an intrinsic property. It's not an intrinsic property because you use a biomorphism, maybe the image is not C2. So it's impossible to talk about Levi pseudoconvexity. Okay. But when you know that it's a C2, you know that it's an holomorphic convex because it's an intrinsic property. And so is a Levi pseudoconvex.
Okay, for example, if you do not destroy the smoothness of the boundary, it's okay.
Yeah, but okay. It's false for strongly. I'm sure this false.
Yeah, for strongly. Yes. Okay.
Maybe you start with the ball, you can find something that is not strongly Levi pseudoconvex.
Okay.
Is Levi pseudoconvex if the boundary is two? Because we will see later there's a link with the holomorphic convexity. This is the Levi problem orally.
Okay, thank you.
But maybe the boundary has not Levi pseudoconvex. Okay?
Okay.
Okay, I want to convince you that it's very easy to compute the Levi form, to check that if a domain is a Levi pseudoconvex and so on. So let's start with, for example, for the ball. Euclidean ball, obviously is strongly convex, so in particular is strongly Levi pseudoconvex. Ammetto. Okay, so we have the ball. The local defined function is a global defined function, is R, the following. And so for every boundary point, you have this is the operator delta PR. And so the complex tangent space, the curve of this operator, and so is this space here that you can compute when you know the boundary point. And Levi form is always equal to this form for every point. It does not depend from the point in the case of the ball. And so the Levi form is possibly defined in all CP. So in particular, in the complex tangent space, for every point. And so the ball is a strong pseudo-convex domain. That means that every point is strong pseudo-convex. Okay. This case is very particular because we don't need to consider this Levi in the form in the tangent space because it's possibly defined in all CD. Okay. Another example is that, for example, the Tulen domain, this domain here. So it's very similar to the ball, but M is an integer bigger than two. This is the defining function. And so if you consider a boundary point, you can compute the Levi form and it's the following. And two is different from zero. This is positive defining the whole CT. So again, is positive defining the complex tangent space. And so the point has strong pseudoconvex. Now we have to check when P2 is equal to zero. If P2 is equal to zero, the point is of this form. And now you can compute the tangent space, the complex tangent space that is a complex space dimension one. So the span of a single vector, this is a vector 0, 1. And so if you compute the Levi form in the generator is equal to zero. So the Levi form in this space is a semi-positive definite, but non-positive definite. No? And so the point is Levi pseudoconvex, but not strongly Levi pseudoconvex when P2 is equal to zero. So morally, we have a domain where all the points are strongly pseudoconvex, Levi pseudoconvex, except for a circle of points where is only Levi pseudoconvex. Okay, so it's not so difficult to compute this this fact. Last example that I think is very interesting. If we consider the CD without at the closure of the ball. So this domain here. Now the boundary is the same of the boundary of the ball, but the defining function is minus the defining function of the ball. And so the Levy form is minus the Levy form of the ball. And so this form is negative defining all CD. In particular, in the complex finite space when D is bigger than two, because if the dimension is one, this space is trivial. And so this form is a positive defining because the space is trivial. So here you can see why it's so important the fact that dimension is bigger than two, bigger or equal than two. And so for every, this is for every boundary point. And so this domain is not Levy pseudocomplex when D is bigger than two. Obviously, when D is equal to one, this is we are in C, so every domain is Levy pseudocomplex. So the dimension is very important. If you remember, if you want, you can image this not a domain homomorphic. Using the Hartog's proof, you can prove that every function in CD without the ball extends to a function in CD. So again, there is a link between a connection between domains homomorphy and Levy pseudoconvexity. And this is, for example, the theorem of Levy. If we have a domain with C2 boundary, a domain homomorphy is always Levy pseudoconvex. So the Levy pseudoconvex is a necessary condition to be a domain homomorphy. The problem that the interesting part is the opposite part, no? We want a domain, we want to do this computation, and we have to be sure that it's a domain homomorphy. This is the famous Levy problem. It's an open question. So the Levy problem is to prove that if we have a domain with C2 boundary, the if it's Levy pseudoconvex, then it's a domain homomorphy. This was an open problem for 40 years. It was solved by Oka using the theory of sheaves, so very geometrical approach. But Romander gave an alternative proof using the theory of PDEs, so using art analysis. And Oka, in order to solve the Levy problem, introduced the plurisupermonic functions that are morally generalization in higher dimension of supermonic functions in C, that are obviously related to homomorphicity, but are very, very flexible, so are very useful. So I will talk about a little bit plurisupermonic functions. First of all, if we have a C2 function in higher dimension, our function is pluriharmonic if the Levy form is equal to zero for every point. So we have this identity for every P and for every J, K. And now you can prove that if we have a point in the domain, you choose a direction. If you consider the Levy form in the direction zeta, this is equal to one quarter the Laplacian of the function when you restrict to the line passing through x in direction zeta. And so using this, this is old for every function u. So you can prove that a function is pluriharmonic if and only if it's harmonic when you restrict this function to every complex unfined line. And so this seems to be the good generalization of harmonic function I had mentioned, because this is false in general for harmonic function in CD. And moreover, we have the proposes a generalization higher dimension of a no result in C. So if we have a domain, you consider a homomorphic function, then the real part is pluriharmonic. And moreover, if the domain is simply connect, the function a pluriharmonic function is the real part of a homomorphic function. Okay, so it's the good generalization of harmonic function and dimension. And now we can define the plurisubharmonic functions in the following way. We consider upper semi-continuous function, that is the more general regularity that we can use in order to define this kind of function. You consider an upper semi-continuous function, you consider a point and another direction, and now you will consider the restriction morally to the line passing through P and direction W. If you want that this is a function in C, if you want that it's superharmonic. This is for every choice of the point, which is the direction. And now we define PSH of D, the space of plurisubharmonic function of D. Okay. And now this is obviously a generalization in a higher dimension of superharmonic functions. In a similar way, we can prove that if the function is a C2 function, then it's PSH, if and only if it's positive semi-definite for every point. So the Levy formula is a generalization of the Laplacian in a higher dimension. And moreover, is a holomorphic variant. So if we have a holomorphic function, U is PSH in D prime, then is a PSH in D. And now the idea of Ockham, when we try to, when he proved the Levy problem, is to generalize the holomorphic convexity using the PSH function. So we consider a domain, a compact set. The PSH convex hull is this, again the same definition. So the points in the domain such that F of Z is smaller than the maximum K of a modulus of F, where F is a PSH function. A compact is PSH convex if the PSH convex hull is equal to F. And domain is pseudo-convex if for each compact set the PSA convex hull is relatively compact indeed. So the same definition of holomorphic convexity, real convexity, and so on. So the idea is always the same. And moreover, since the
wait a second, Matteo, but you yeah. had another definition, right? Of pseudo-convex. No.
It like it's Levy pseudo-convex when is
okay, yeah. Good.
Yeah, there is this problem, but we say at the end of this talk that all these conditions are the same, are equivalent. So
okay, spoiler.
Equivalent condition. Okay. So now in the Leech, when you read the paper, pseudo convex means domains holomorphic convexity, and so on. But this fact was an open problem for 40 years, so it's not so easy to prove that all these conditions are the same. So now pseudo-convex, historically, I think pseudo-convex the first time in the world is here from Mocha. Because it's a generalization, we see that it's a generalization of Levy pseudo-convexity without the C2 condition. Okay, PSH convex alley, so again, it's in the condition. Now, since the PSH functions, a pluriharmonic function is a PSH function, and the pluriharmonic function are the real part of homomorphic function, it's not so difficult to prove that this convex hull, the PSH convex hull, is inside the homomorphic convex hull. So, in particular, if a domain is homomorphically convex, is a pseudo-convex. Why is they are so interesting this PSH function? Because, for example, if I have a domain, delta d is the distance from zeta from zeta to the boundary. You can prove that if d is pseudo convex in this sense, then minus log of this function is a PS function. Is a PSH function that explodes near the boundary, no? Because the distance goes to zero, except for infinity. And so we add this part here to obtain a function that near the boundary, also near the infinity, goes to infinity. And this is a PSH, because it's a maximum between two PSH functions, is a PSH exhaustion function. So it's a continuous function such that sublevels are relatively compact. And now you can prove that domain is pseudo-convex if and only if there exists a PSH exhaustion function. And the existence of this function that can be this, for example, we can choose this, is the main tool in order to prove the Levy problem according to Ormander, so using PD. Moreover, you can prove that when you know that these are C2 boundaries, so we have some regularity, then Levy pseudo-convex is equivalent to pseudo-convex. So this is a generalization also for non-smooth domains of Levy pseudo-convex. Okay, so this is only a reformulation of the Levy pseudo-convexity, more general, because we don't need regularity. Now I want to talk about the solution of the Levy problem according to the Ormander proof. And the idea is to solve the Cauchy-Riemann equation using the Dolbeau homology. So we have a domain in CD. We can consider the non-homogeneous Cauchy-Riemann equations, so that this family of partial differential equations. So we have to find a G such that we have the zeta bar J, while Fj, where Fj are C1 functions. Obviously, if a solution exists, we need some condition for Fj's, because we can apply, for example, here the bar zeta k. And so since it's a C2 function, we can change the order of the derivation. So we obtain the following integrability condition for the Fj. So if a solution exists, Fj have the following integrability condition. And now these are very classical strategy in algebraic topology when you have this differential equation with a condition. You can change, we can use the language to differential forms to reformulate the problem. So we consider a form, a 0-1 form, 0 because there is nothing in the zeta, and 1 because the degree in zeta bar is 1, such that the bar of f is equal to 0. Now it's a very, I wouldn't want to go deep up for the definition, but the bar f more or less is the condition. So if we have a form where the bar is equal to 0, we have to find a g such that the bar of g is equal to f. This is the formulation of the existence of the solution of the Cauchy-Riemann equations. Now, when we have this stuff, that if you know that is equal to, this is a form where the bar is equal to 0, find a solution of this equation. The existence of a solution is equivalent morally to a vanishing of a group of cohomology. So a group that you can define for every domain, for every space, at least the Dolbeau homology. In this case, for this equation, is the group 0-1, the bar. And now, if you consider morally other differential forms that I have mentioned, we can also define h, p, q, delta bar for each p and q. And now, here, this is the very, very hard part of the Levy problem. You can prove that if we know that the groups are trivial for p bigger than 0 and p bigger than 1, then it's a domain homomorphy. And for the reason, the Levy problem can be solved if we prove the following theorem. So if the domain is pseudo-convex, then we have this, the Dolbeau homology is trivial. Okay. But now this is a PD. So if we know the convex, we can solve the. We have to prove that we can solve the Cauchy-Riemann equation. So the idea of Mander is to write this equation as a PD, a weak solution, a weak interpretation of this PD, using spaces. So we used the classical technique. So there exists a weak solution for the weak formulation of this equation. And then we have to prove that the weak solution is a strong solution using bootstrap techniques and so on. So this is the hard part of the problem. This is the proof of Ormander. And the fact that it's pseudo-convex, the hypothesis of pseudo-convexity is using the fact that you can find a good extraction function, such that you have good estimates of the coefficients of the PD. So more this is idea. And so, for example, using the Mander theorem, you can this, so applies the Z-homomorphism. So this is the solution of the Levy problem. And so we can construct the following big theorem. We have a domain, then the following are equivalent. Domain holomorphy is equivalent to holomorphically convex. So an intrinsic property, a property that does not change with change the domain with something that is holomorphic. Pseudo-convex, so the condition with PSH function, admits a PSH extraction function. For each compact, the holomorphic convex hull is equal to the PSH convex hull. Here's something about the cohomology group, so the arterial for P bigger than 0, Q bigger than 1. And moreover, if C2 is a Levy pseudo-convex. So for example, in your question about if we have two domains that are C2, since a domain that is Levy pseudo-convex is holomorphically convex, this is an intrinsic property, so also the image is holomorphically convex, so is a Levy pseudo-convex. So, but the fact that you can establish this missing in general. So the proof, I think the only proof that you can use to prove that is invariant in this sense is using the holomorphic. And so this is the big theorem that I think is a very interesting part. And so now in literature, when you see pseudo convex means one of the following conditions that are equivalent. Okay, maybe, okay, I think we can stop here.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Matteo. Thanks a lot for this mostly instructive seminar. Before asking the others if they have questions, I have a question. What is a good reference for pedestrians? To see.
Okay.
You taught many things, but if I want to find, I don't know,
reference. Yeah, there is the book Ormander, very interesting because Ormander was an analyst for PD, no? It's not from a convex geometry, convex analysis. And he wrote a book where the part about the convex case, the complex case is very precise and so on. And the part about the Levy problem with subwave spaces is very, very fast and it's not so easy to understand. Probably the other part, so the, for example, PSH function, Levy pseudo convexity, is a very good reference. The book, I don't remember, but I think is Ormander, seven complex analysis in several complex variables, something like that. I think the only book that Ormander wrote for complex analysis.
Okay, thanks a lot.
But I think, Nicola, another reference where I read some of this stuff is for sure the book by Krantz. Given trans and complex analysis in several complex variables, something like that. But also the book by Prang is the title is holomorphic. Just a moment, I Google the title. Integral representation. Sorry. Okay. See all. By Michael Runge, holomorphic function and integral representation in several complex variables. It's another reference that I know. So,
yeah, I think every book that for several complex variables, there is a part about this stuff because it's very classical. Because obviously, when you want to study, for example, space of function or multi-function functions, we need to know this stuff because, for example, it's a user to study the space or homomorphic function in this space because it's the same space of the bidisk, you know. So you need to know that domains and domains homomorphic. The optimal domain to study. This is not a good domain to study because more or less it's the same of the bidisk. So I think every book in several complex variables, you can find something about maybe Lewis pseudo convexity or homomorphic convexity. The book homology is more technical.
Matteo, sorry, can I ask you another question?
Yeah, sure.
If you go to your last theorem, because I knew some of this stuff, but I don't really remember it. So here you said before that, so if you have a C2 domain which is Levi pseudo convex, it is also holomorphically convex. So if you consider the image via a biholomorphic map, also so holomorphically convex is an intrinsic property. So if you take a biholomorphic image of your domain, is again holomorphically convex. Is it that correct?
Yeah.
What you said?
Yeah.
Okay. So then in the end, you can say that the pseudo convexity is a biholomorphic, is an invariant for biholomorphism.
The Levi pseudo convexity?
No, the holomorphically convexity.
Yeah, it's a biholomorphic invariant. Yeah.
Okay, but because when you were talking about the Levi pseudo convexity, you said that you need the biholomorphism to extend to a neighborhood of the domain. Or maybe I'm missing something.
Yeah, if you want to prove that directly, you know.
Okay. So you're saying that if you want to prove directly that Levi pseudo convexity is biholomorphically invariant, you need the biholomorphism to extend on the closure in an neighborhood of the domain of the closure.
Because it only uses the chain rule.
Okay. But
in the chain rule, you need to know that the. It is important because also if you consider you start with a domain that is strongly Levi pseudo convex, it's not true that an image is strongly Levi pseudo convex. Also, if you know that it's C2 boundary, it is C2 boundary.
Okay, so but in the end, everything is equivalent. So if you could prove that,
strongly is different, no? For example, you start with a ball that's strongly pseudo convex. Maybe the image is C2, but it's not strongly Levi pseudo convex. It's Levi pseudo convex, obviously, for the fact that you say so.
Okay.
So for example, if you consider a biholomorphism from the ball to something, and you consider the biholomorphism restricted to a smaller ball, the image is always strongly Levi pseudo convex because the biholomorphism is defined in a neighborhood, no?
Ah, yeah, sure.
But maybe the image of the ball is not, maybe it's not C2, so it's very bad.
Yeah, sure. Okay.
But it's impossible to prove, it's possible to prove this directly that the Levi pseudo convex is intrinsic, I think.
I get it. I mean, if you want just to use Levi pseudo convexity, you have this kind of problem. But in the end, if you have the equivalence of all these,
you can always rely
on holomorphically convex and conclude that is it pseudo convexity in the more general.
I lost you. Ti ho perso, non so se...
Sì, penso che Alessandro...
Dove... Ah, ok, l'abbiamo perso tutti.
No, no, io ci sono. Ci sei?
Sì, sì.
Ah, ok.
Dico, tutti abbiamo perso lui. No?
Sì, 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 abbiamo perso Alessandro.
No, sono
sì.
Ah, ok.
Ciao Michelangelo.
Ciao.
Ah, ecco, Ale, ciao.
Sì, scusate. No, stavo dicendo, Matteo, in the end, if you have, if you use holomorphically convex, the pseudo-convexity in the more general sense is by holomorphically invariant.
Esatto.
Ok, grazie. Scusa, che ci
metto... No, no, no. You... I think this is the best, yeah. The fact this is very good to... For this reason, that is intrinsic, no? That a priori, domain holomorph is an intrinsic definition, so...
Yeah,
also like pseudo convex.
Okay, are there other questions?
Yes. Yeah, so I had major connection problems, so I lost most of the talk. I'm sorry. So I will need to so I got disconnected after like 10 minutes and then I came back in the last five. So most likely my question is out of date. But when I got disconnected, you were talking about, you were introducing this holomorphic convex hull.
Mm-hmm.
And then I got disconnected. Sorry. I was wondering, did you provide any easy examples of concrete examples of domains for which the holomorphic convex hull does not coincide with the standard notion of convex hull?
Okay. There is an example here. Maybe you just... Oh, for example, if you consider maybe an example in C, you consider C star, the domain is C star.
Mm-hmm.
So C without the R, and the compact set is the circle, the unit sphere. So, and now the convex hull here is itself, is all the convex. You can prove it.
Mm-hmm.
If you see if domain is C, the convex hull is of the disk. Is domain is C star, you have 1/z, and you can prove that so the closure of the unit circle is itself. So OD convex when D is a C star. So it's not a convex compact set. Or if you want, very yeah, this is not this is for example it's convex. So yeah, if you consider CT.
Okay. Thanks.
So if there are no other questions, I have okay. There is one thing. Because something I'd be very interested in, and I guess maybe other people, it is in understanding why a strongly pseudo-convex domain can be approximated by
balls.
By the balls. Yeah, and in which sense? Because I think this is a technical tool we need also to, you know, to do some further research for.
But the fact that for this convex is morally very, very, has a lot of probability that morally is very, very similar to the board. For example, you can prove that if the point is strongly pseudo convex, locally, you can find a change in the coordinates where the domain becomes strongly convex.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So it's very, it's a Narasimhan lemma. This fact, you can use the squeezing function. But the problem that now I I don't know how to write something to explain this part. So maybe the next week I can write something. Yeah, you okay, have to buy some tablet. But morally, when you you have a strong epsilon convex point, if you approach with a sequence of points, yeah, morally you have a ball. Morally, your domain is very similar to the ball. For example, using Kobayashi, so the Kobayashi distance, the Kobayashi metric is very similar to the Kobayashi metric of the ball.
Yeah, but I'm sure this is good for another talk.
It was okay, three slides.
Won't it be a polite pressure to?
Yeah, it's a bonus track for the next talk. Okay.
On this one. Okay, so next time. Okay, we are not asking you to do a Beamer presentation. No, because you said that you could talk about
the gram of hyperbolicity
next week. Is it okay?
I think, yeah.
Okay, but even if you write with a pen and then you make a PDF, that's okay.
I don't know. Now I have to decide.
Right. By the way, that's another thing which is more technical. We are full of graphic tablets. Or Giovanna, what's the correct name of that?
A tavolette grafiche.
Tavolette grafiche.
Ce l'ho. A me me l'ha pensato il dipartimento a Roma, però adesso non posso neanche chiedere.
But I can ask if it's possible to send you one.
No, send you one, don't worry.
We're sending them to students. I'll ask if it's possible. Okay, great. Next week, if you give the seminar on Gromov spaces, that would be great. And if there are no other volunteers, I could make a follow-up small seminar about the basics of Kobayashi, Bergman, whatever, geometry on the Siegel domain. So to define the Siegel domain and to talk about the geometry there. And I do that just for people who are interested, because just to have a frame in which doing calculations of the kind I was talking about on Dirichlet spaces and the like. Okay, well, thanks a lot, Matteo. I will stop the registration.
Grazie a voi.
Grazie, Marco.